Follow the narrative. Okay, it's all important. Whatever you're studying, whatever you're interested in, follow the narrative. Don't lose track of the narrative. Where is it going? Whatever success and clarification I've had comes from being able to follow the narrative. If I'm when I was studying, I just kept going and saying, okay, if I don't quite get this, that's okay. Don't get this, just try and keep going towards, where is it going? What's the goal? What is the purpose of this? What is the narrative? What's the purpose of the narrative? All the little details and stuff like that that you know, like your teachers would like test you on is stupid. Don't pay attention. Don't worry about that. Don't worry. Don't worry about pronunciation so much or grammar or all this picky stuff which deflects you away from the narrative. And some who don't want to follow the narrative, what they'll do is they'll ask you trivial questions, trivial stuff. Like you're driving somewhere and they're saying, how many miles do these tires have on, you know, so how much gasoline do you still have, or what year is this car, what's, you know, just trying to like ask all these questions that don't really have to do with the road ahead and where you're going. This can be carried out in all different walks of life, you know. What time is it? When do we start? How long have we been doing it? You know, stuff like that is purposefully deflects away from the narrative. Details, trivial details. But when someone's really on the narrative, they don't care about stuff like that. You know, they see looking at the road ahead. Say, okay, you know, if you're driving, you know, you're seeing the road ahead and saying, okay, I see the traffic up there and this and this and that. You're not answering questions about the traffic back behind you and where you've already been behind you, et cetera, et cetera. You're focused on, you realize you've got to, you know, navigate what's ahead of you. And the narrative is all important. The details are not important. And when people start to say, oh boy, I'm losing the narrative, or I don't want to go there, then they'll start asking trivial questions, or, you know, hey, you know, what about this and this and that date, this and that, specifically this, what do you mean about that, details, to lose sight of the narrative. We live in a culture that is almost devoid of capability to follow narrative. The focus on triviality is part of that. It's unintentionally. Because if we were able to focus on a narrative and follow it, we would focus on the narrative of repentance and salvation and freedom and sidestepping the sacrifice and sidestepping loss and being reacquainted with reality. We'd focus on that narrative. And it takes the ability, it's a skill to focus on a narrative. And likewise, that skill can be undermined and termited by constantly training us to focus off of the narrative onto just fragments and details and trivia that is really, in and of itself, has no meaning whatsoever. It has no direction, no narrative, no real purpose. It only maybe incidentally serves the purpose of, but it's not the purpose itself. And so our attention gets deflected away from following a narrative onto trivia. And we have a culture of trivia, you know. Think about it. You're brought up on, you know, board games, trivia, you know. It's a way to keep your mind off an important narrative. Narrative is a big picture. Narrative is, you know, big picture. Narrative here is aligning yourself so the Passover principle will work for you automatically, so that you can find yourself in a loss-free scenario. Okay, like that is the narrative. How to prepare for that? That's the narrative too. These, you know, make some goals. keep the narrative going, keep the momentum going, etc. It's a big picture thing. The narrative is to choose what you really want instead of what you think you want. That's the narrative too. Okay, big picture narrative. You don't have to get lost in, now what kind of things do you really want, or what do you think you want, and well, what about this? Do I really want this or that? What about that? Before you know it, the air's out of the balloon, right? The opportunity has been dissipated, because a lot of times when your opportunity's knocking, you have to grab it right then and there. Carpe diem, seize the day, seize the moment, and advance the narrative. And the world is literally training itself in how to deflect away from the narrative of salvation. How to do that. And the people in the world now are so trained in this, so trained at all levels now. It's unbelievable how tough it's been to maintain this narrative over all these years. It used to be like in the 60s, people were very much on the narrative, you know, the big picture. A lot of people were training themselves to think, you know, that way, follow the narrative. What's the big picture? They were using it in a lot of, you know, socially active ways, and the Vietnam War, how to, you know, all sorts of social movements, etc. But they were at least keeping their eye on the prize, civil rights movement, all sorts of different movements, feminist movement, women's liberation movement, all these different, you know, movements. They had their eye on what they saw as their prize, and they just followed that narrative for that. So at least their thinking was that way, as far as being able to maintain focus on a narrative. Now, what I'm pointing out is this narrative has different goals, which is a goal of freedom from the cycles of existence, freedom from suffering, freedom from death, freedom from loss, freedom from insecurity, freedom from everything that has bedeviled us, and a reacquaintance with reality instead of this hypothetical scenario of loss that we are experiencing, we think we're experiencing as existence. That's the narrative here. It's the most profound narrative that is talking, going towards what we really want instead of what we think we want. These other movements are what people thought they wanted, but they did keep their eye on that and advance the narrative and not worry about so much about the details. And that's an important skill. You can transfer that skill over to the narrative of what you really want. You can transfer that over, and I advise doing that. So instead of saying, yeah, I got caught up on all these social agendas pursuing what I thought that I wanted, and it was a waste of time, it doesn't have to be, because if you transfer that skill of following a narrative and forgetting about all these little stumbling blocks, you know. When you're riding like your trail bike, your bicycle, and the trail up ahead is going like this and that and down, and you know, you are looking at what is the route that I can take to make this. You're not concerned about counting how many pebbles you pass by, or rocks pass by, or all this stupid stuff, and you know, trivia. No, you're right in the moment saying, okay, this is how I'm going to navigate this. And anything other than that is not important. It's not important. So we are at a time now, we have to navigate a situation that is very bumpy, as it were. And so we have to stay, you know, laser-like focus on how do we navigate this. Forget about trivial stuff, you know. How many etheric parasites are there? Is there a million or 2 million, 3? It doesn't matter. You know, even the fact they're etheric parasites doesn't really matter. It's all part of the same loss-based scenario. It's all of existence is that. And we can get free of all of it. It will have to pass us by if we have the right attitude. It has to pass us by without us doing anything other than having the right attitude and direction and willingness to accept what we really want. Existence has to pass us by. It's automatic. That is the narrative that we're advancing here. So advancing the narrative is super important. Details are super unimportant. Okay, in your life, keep that in mind. And you know when people are trying to trip you up, when they keep throwing all these, you know, bogus trivial questions, like they're really important. Got to answer this, got to answer that, or else, you know, I'm not going to believe in anything you're saying. Doesn't matter, right? Those things don't matter. It means, well, that they don't like the narrative, where the narrative is going, so they're trying to slow it down and change the directions of the narrative, where it's going, change the goal in there. They say, oh, you're very talented, you're very capable of presenting a narrative, but we'd like you to change your goal and use your skills and talents to get some other narrative, so we're gonna trip you up, kind of thing. And you gotta refuse, say, no, forget it, I'm not gonna play that game, keep going. It's all important right now. Keep advancing the narrative as fast as possible. And the things that happen now, don't worry about what's happening as far as incidentals and stuff. Again, what's happening in the world now and what's going to happen in the future should not matter to us, because we are aligning with the Passover principle, aligning with what we really want, aligning with the realization that our resume of loss is useless to us. It's nothing. Gets us absolutely nowhere. We don't need it. We don't need to pad it anymore. Whatever we've done, but we don't need to pad it anymore. And we can even let go of whatever resume we do have, or just set it down and pay no more attention to it. Of course, if we're adding to it, we must be worried that it's not enough. And we probably know, hey, you know, I've got all this suffering, but it's not enough. I needed more. Instead, we can set the resume aside and just say, you know, it's a useless piece of paper, as it were, and don't need to add anything to it. Don't even need to know what's on it anymore. I can forget all about it. I can forget all about the resume. The resume of loss. Resume of suffering, resume of destruction, resume of change. It's just not worth anything to us. We can get there. So we have to keep advancing that narrative in the face of a world which absolutely has no interest in that narrative. The narrative the world is advancing is, how do we pad our resumes, our loss-based resumes? That's what because that's what the world believes salvation is, that God has to make a deal and that'll be our salvation. But we know our narrative is that God can never make any deal on reality, cannot. And that is our salvation. Accepting this and realizing it is our salvation, because then we'll give up trying to pad our resume in order to try to get a deal out of God. Cannot get a deal out of God. God cannot change reality, not even a tiny fragment of it. And I know we keep saying, with God, everything is possible. God cannot change reality. Cannot. Because if God were to change reality, God would be changing itself. It would no longer be what it is. And that's not possible. So, do not expect that. Do not follow that narration, that believing that God can change reality. It's not possible. Any change of reality totally nullifies all of reality. It's no more. So, will never happen. And we need to get away from that narrative, get on the right narrative that aligns us with truth, with the facts, with what really is possible. And what's possible is for us to let go of this effort to pad our loss, our resume of loss. That is possible. And we can do that. So let's do that. That is what is possible. We can either keep trying to pad it, keep padding it, or give up the effort to pad our resume. That's the choice we have. So we can make a choice. We can do that. Absolutely, we can do that. And most of the world is just, again, not aware of this narrative at all. At all. And who knows what's going to happen. This is August, what is it, the 11th or something like that, on a Saturday. We have 20 days left in August. A lot can happen in 20 days. We want to, moving time can be either an actual moving, or it can be a moving of our wheels, alignment, moving of our alignment, so that we're properly aligned for a big boost, a big push. And this is the month that we really need to do it. Don't wait until September. Don't wait. Do not wait, okay? Keep your efforts going every single day. Some of you are doing that. Keep your efforts going every day. If you wait and say, well, I'll do it later. Because the world is very conflicted. And nothing good comes out of conflict. The conflictedness that's going on is, it's not going to get lighter and brighter at this point. The hope that it will is really the hope that somehow all this, the fact that we're on the precipice, is going to pressure God, and God will say, okay, I'll make a deal. I'm afraid that you might gain some awesome power of destructivity over reality, so I'll make a deal now. That's so people are assuming that this will happen, and so they feel kind of confident, like, we can avert everything. We can avert everything. Everything will be averted and everything will be fine. If anything is averted, it's not because of that factor at all. You know, if anything's averted, it's simply because we decide to double down. That's the only reason. We decide to double down on everything. But I tell you right now, it's getting tougher and tougher to double down. We've already doubled down so many times. So many times. And to double down again, I don't see that happening. I don't see that happening. It is not impossible that we could double down again. It's not impossible, but I don't think it'll happen. And so it doesn't matter whether it does or not, the situation still remains the same. The intensity might be slightly less, but the whole dynamic of the whole existence remains exactly the same. The remedy remains exactly the same. And the fact is that we are in an time of extreme pressure remains the same. The fact that we are being pushed to lose sight of our narrative is the same. Everything remains the same. And the fact that things are going to deteriorate remains the same. It's just, you know, the idea that, well, is the entire thing going to go under soon, or is it going to double down? You know, that's the question. But it's kind of like, are you going to, you know, you're off a cliff and you're falling. Are you going to hit the ground in 2 seconds or 1 second? You know, that's kind of where we're at. And, you know, to the one that is falling, it, you know, that doesn't really matter, does it? It doesn't really matter. Let's just imagine you're falling and you realize you're going to hit the ground in either, you know, 2 seconds or 1 second. You're not quite sure. Are you going to sit there calculating, say, now, wait a minute. It's gravity, my weight, the distance, where I fell from, and try to say, well, calculate it all in your mind. Spend the last 2 seconds, you know, of your life trying to figure out whether you're going to hit in 2 seconds or 1 second, or are you going to say, whoa, I better learn to be to float. I better learn to fly right now. Right now. I better learn to fly right now. I better suddenly get wings, you know, and glide out of the fall. So you're not thinking about trying to come up with the answer. Is it going to be 2 seconds or 1 second before you hit the ground? No way. If you do, you're an idiot, you know. Let's face it, that is madness. That's not advancing a narrative of escape. It's a narrative of victimization. Am I going to pad my victim resume in 2 seconds or 1 second is what they would be asking. Instead, they say, I don't care whether it's two or one. That's totally irrelevant. What is relevant is me getting a pair of wings right now. What's relevant is that ground becoming entirely permeable. What is relevant is my body becoming totally spacious and permeable. You know, what is relevant is to not hit the ground. That is what's relevant. That is the narrative. And we're in a situation just like that. Is that serious? So the narrative has to be focused in the right place right now, and that is what we're doing here, focusing it in the right place and advancing the narrative. You know, we're not just stagnant or static, we're advancing the narrative. Push, come on, you know, 2 seconds, 1.8, 1.7, 1.65, 1.4, 1.3, you know, and we say, come on, push, it's not too late. And so, you know, we don't know whether the problems will come in 2 seconds or 1 second, the real severe stuff, but it's going to come. So why worry about exactly when it's going to come? That's not important. It's not important. What's important is that it's going to be soon. And what's important is that it's soon enough that we need to grow wings, that we need to adopt align ourselves with the Passover principle. That is what is important. Super important. And so that's why more and more and more I'm less and less and less into whether it's 2 seconds or 1 second. Basically, what I've said is that it's going to be very soon, and it could be this soon, it might not, they might double down on it. You see, there's always the possibility of doubling down. It's hard to determine that, and we have doubled down already. There have been some doubling down already taking place, and that's a variable which is difficult. It's difficult to discern, and it's not important. Again, whether it's 2 seconds or 1 second is not relevant, right? It's not even relevant if it's 5 seconds. Because what are you going to do in 5 seconds? I mean, the urgency is there. The proximity is there. The momentum is there. Everything is there. And we don't want to have impact. We don't have a stopwatch. We're not like scientists saying, okay, I want to, you know, click this stopwatch just before I impact, so at least I'll leave this stopwatch so everybody can see how long it took me to fall. You know, just stupid stuff, trivial stuff. People are engaged in these trivial pursuits that are so stupid. Forget about all trivia. Advance the narrative of repentance and salvation, and advance your understanding of what that is way above and beyond whatever narrative was previously in the world, whatever it may be. Don't even judge that stuff. Don't even waste your time arguing about stuff. I mean, of course this narrative has not been fine-tuned in the world at all. It's gotten very dull, very fuzzy. Doesn't matter. Don't waste your time on criticizing previous clumsy attempts at this narrative. It's not important. You know, that's useless to us. The only thing's important is to get the narrative right now, is to get clear about it right now. It's all, doesn't matter. Everything else doesn't matter. And yet, everyone wants us to spend our time, you know, rehashing. Well, people back in the past, they've been saying that salvation is this, or repentance is this, and you got to do that. Now, how do you answer to them and what they said? And, you know, just ridiculous stuff. Who cares? Right? At this point, who cares? All that's important is we get it clear right now. If we get it clear right now, that's it. We succeeded. And how can you argue with success, right? Failure can be rehashed a million times, right? But success, you don't need to rehash anything. You got it done. Like someone said to me a couple days ago, he's doing this job and he has to get it done, you know, and he has to be done today, you know, because he has to take a flight and fly across country and start another project there. And he says, I'm talking with him, and he just briefly asking him just, you know, polite niceties, just a few things. And then he says, hey, get her done. I said, yeah, get her done. Meaning, hey, I got to get this thing done today. You know, he had to get it done today. It's a big installation project. And he knew he had to get it done today. So, sure, he said, you know, spent like 10 seconds, 15 seconds, or maybe 20, I don't know. It was a very short time. Just, hey, you know, how's it going? You do a lot of these. Where do you do them? Blah, blah, blah. Okay. And he said, all right, get her done. Boom. He was right to it. And he got it done. Same thing here. Sure, we can talk about some certain things in passing, but let's not get hung up on any of that stuff, because we got to get her done, which means get our alignment right, so when the big boost comes, you know, we're not angled off at 45 degrees. We're straight on. You know, we understand the Passover principle. We understand that we've been trying to hoodwink the Prime Creator into getting the Prime Creator to change reality for us. We understand that's impossible. And we've been trying to build up a resume of loss and vulnerability to try and threaten the Prime Creator into doing this. And we realize it doesn't work at all. It doesn't work at all. And so that's the kind of alignments that we need. We need these alignments so when the push comes, so to speak, we go straight on down the track. And you know, our hands on the wheel straight. We're not veering off here, veering off there. We're not slamming on the brakes saying, whoa, I better go explain now. How is this different from, you know, the 18th century exposition of what salvation was or what rapture is and how did it develop and what about this thing, blah, 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 blah. Ridiculous. Trivia. Only matters now is getting it right. Not pointing out who was wrong in the past. That's a waste of time. Why do we care? You know, who and what and all the stuff in the past about fumbling it, you know. Sure, there's been fumbles and bumbles and we haven't got it clear yet, but we're almost there. And we have to get it clear right now. We have to get it now. Now is the time when we have to get it. In the past, they didn't feel like they really had to get it right. They felt like they had enough time to fumble it around, you know, fumble it around. Right now, we have to get it right. There's no time to fumble it right now because we're up against the clock, as it were, very much so. It's like a game, like the end of the game. You're up against the clock and you need to score. If you don't score, you're going to lose the game. And so, you know, you're not focusing on anything previously in the game. You're focused on how much time is on the clock, and I've got to score before that clock expires. That's all. Only thing that's important. You're not thinking about, well, I fumbled, you know, back then, and had a bad play back then, and blah, blah, blah. No, no, no. Forget it. Score now. So, of course, in the past, that people kicked it around. A lot of people kicked it around. A lot of people philosophized about it. A lot of people kind of guessed at it. A lot of people kind of flirted with it. A lot of people thought about it, kind of what they think they want. And, you know, of course they didn't get it right. And because they felt, you know, I got plenty of time to get it right. So it's not that urgent. Now it's a tremendous urgency to get it right. So we got to get it right. That's what enables us to have a better clarity than in the past by far. It's not even close. Not even close. You can't even compare. I don't even spend any time, you know, thinking about that. But I know for a fact that the clarity that's being shared here and the focus is way better than in the past. Way better. Because of this intense urgency that if we don't get it done now, we're in a heap of trouble. And more trouble than we possibly want to be in. And, you know, time's up. It's like that. It's like, who studies the hardest? The person, you know, a month before the test, or the person two days before the test? Or the person, you know, the night before, who's studying harder, you know? Who has the greater intensity of focus and determination? It's the one that is up against the deadline that has the best focus and concentration, for sure. And so, you know, as we get close to this deadline, that is driving the focus, is driving the concentration, driving the determination, the intensity. It's saying, get her done. We got to get her done here, now, and no second chance. I mean, we're out of chances, so to speak. I mean, as far as sidestepping this upcoming sacrificial scenario, you know, we're just about out of time. So that should bring about the intensity of focus now. And I think that some in the world are still playing it cool. Like, I think I'm pretty close, you know. So I don't want to see have anyone see me sweat, so because they might think I'm not as smart as I think I am. So I'm gonna play it cool. Don't play it cool. Don't play it cool. Sweat right now. Sweat it out. Anybody who really was smart would be sweating it out. So those people are playing it cool. They don't know what's going on, really. They're not nearly as smart as they try to present themselves to be, because if they were, they would know that they have to get it right now. And they would be sweating it out. They'd be grinding it out. They'd be pulling all-nighter. You know, they would just be pouring it on, pouring it on. You get near the finish line, and I've done this in I used to run up in the mountains, and just come out exhausted, absolutely, like I could hardly, you know, put another step forward. And yet I'd get close, and I'd see I'm getting close to the finish line, and I'd put on a sprint, and then I'd see the finish line, and I'd just even stronger sprint, and just, you know, blaze through the finish line, even though I felt like I was dead, you know, because I didn't. But it's amazing what seeing the finish line can do for you. Absolutely amazing. And I was able to do some times that were just incredible. I had no way could I do that. But as soon as I caught wind of that finish line, I'd say, hey, you know, maybe I can do it. Then I just pour it on, pour it on. Pour it on. You can pour it on right now. Don't hold back. Pour it on, you know. Now's the time to pour it on. It's either that or play it cool. Those who play it cool are fools. They'll be played for fools. There's no time to play it cool right now. It's time to pour it on. In the right way, meaning advance the narrative towards the Passover principle. There is a principle. People wonder, how can we escape this? There is a principle that is automatic. Automatic. And it's so simple. You know, I said, how could I not have seen that all this time? Because we're still thinking about, hey, you know, maybe we should pad our loss resume of loss. Maybe we should pad that. You know, this opportunity to pad our resume is so intense, so extreme. It's like so abundance. We'll have this massive abundance to pull in all this additions to our resume of suffering, victimization, and all this stuff, destructivity. And we're thinking, yeah, I don't know if I really want to miss that. You know, that's opportunity is really strong. And so we don't really look at the Passover principle, because if we saw it, we'd say, oh my gosh, I can be free. So we don't really look at the answer where the answer is. We just haven't done it. Just haven't done it. I look back and say, how could I have missed that? It's so obvious. When you see it, it's so obvious. And yet, we don't see it. We don't see it. Because again, we don't, we're kind of like saying, well, maybe I can have my cake and eat it too. Maybe I can pad my resume and at the same time follow the narrative of repentance and stuff. The narrative of repentance leads to paradise. It leads to dwelling in the loss-free realm, the realm that is free of all loss, and there's no way to pad your resume there. You can't do both. You cannot follow that narrative to its conclusion and pad your victim, you know, resume. It's impossible. There's no loss there. There's no harm. It's perfect. You're perfectly safe. Perfectly safe. Everything there is perfectly safe. Effortlessly safe. So you cannot pad the resume of loss. You can't say, oh, that tree, it was there before, but a storm knocked it down and I lost my favorite tree. No, there are no storms. Nothing's being knocked down. Nothing's being harmed in any way. So you cannot decide to pad your resume of loss at the same time dwell in paradise. It's not possible. Not possible. Because if you wanted to pad your resume, you'd say, ah, there's nothing here for me. And that's literally what people say. They would say, get me out of this place. I can't you know, there's no salvation here, because I believe my salvation depends on padding my resume of loss to the point where I can con the prime creator into changing a little bit of reality, which will change all of reality, which will enable me to be prime creator. So there's nothing here for me, nothing here. You see, so really it's super important to make the push now, because the opportunity to pad your loss resume is going to become, the opportunities will start coming so strong that we'll get tempted. You know, we'll start to get really tempted. I said, oh my gosh, you know, I want to turn on the news. You know, there's just been this terrible something, something somewhere, you know, and oh, holy cow, you know, this is big time loss. Maybe I better pay attention to it. Don't want to miss this opportunity, right? That's the feeling. Oh, we don't want to, you know, the regular everyday stuff. Okay, we're not going to spend our time reading the obituaries, but this thing, wow, this is really a heavy situation. You know, maybe, you know, this is like a, you know, massive tsunami. Whoa, I better pay attention to that. Otherwise, I'll miss this opportunity to perceive loss of all different types. I mean, like the Japanese, the tsunami on the northeastern coast there. I used to live there, as a matter of fact, and people, very great people up there, I'll tell you that. Some of the finest people you'll ever meet lived up there. And when this tsunami hit, you know, I didn't pay any attention to it really at all. You know, someone told me about it, and I looked at it, and I saw it, and I said, wow. But then, you know, that's enough. I don't want to follow that narrative. I don't want to follow the narrative of the tsunami, okay? Same with the World Trade Center, same with the wars in Iran, Iraq, all this stuff. I don't want to follow those scenarios. Whatever these scenarios of loss are, it won't benefit me to follow them. It won't benefit me. So we'll be presented with all these opportunities to follow these narratives. We already have been, to tell you the truth. There have been some major, major, major calamities over the last 10, 11 years, and coming on strong. And now we've got, you know, more and more and more building up. And, you know, it looks like prophecy is coming true as far as all the afflictions, the droughts, the floods, and, you know, there'll be pestilence and wars and all this kind of stuff. Do we want to follow those narratives is the question. But if we are not pushing the narrative of repentance and paradise, loss-free realm, if we're not pushing that narrative, our attention is going to get hooked on to following these narratives of loss, because they're going to be very intense and very kind of like, wow. People look at it like, yeah. And they'll be on the news 24/7. People will be, you know, looking at what's going on all the time. And they will feel like, hey, you know, we're really padding our resume fantastically here. This is great. We got all of the interconnectivity of the world now, and the ability to spread this information, all this loss-based narratives all over the world, so everybody can follow them if they want to, really. But you can choose not to follow them. Don't follow them. You could absolutely do that. When I pass an accident on the side of the road, I don't even look. Don't even look. I might just, if I see something, I just glance to make sure the police are there, okay? The firemen are there, okay? Paramedics, everything, okay? Fine. The experts are there, the pros are there. I don't need to assess anything, right? If there's nobody there, then I might, you know, stop and try to help. That's happened sometimes. Yeah, whew, boy. It's happened several times where I was a first responder on the scene. Called 911, got the experts there, and then okay, got the heck out of there. I didn't want to follow the narrative. It's like that. If you're a first responder, do what you need to do. Otherwise, don't follow the narrative. It's that simple. And then just keep your attention like a laser on salvation, on your freedom from suffering, on your freedom from death. All of that is more than possible. It's a certainty. Passover principle, if you're aligned in the right direction, has to pass you by. Even death has to pass you by. Has to pass you by, because it doesn't see anything there to die. Because you've already died to death, as it were. You're willing to give up the loss-based narrative, the narrative of loss. You're willing to give that up. You don't want to pad your resume anymore. You're willing to give up that resume padding. So You know, no more death. You don't need to die. You don't need to suffer. None of that. And these are the real objectives. Don't let the world tell you otherwise. Don't let them tell you otherwise, because they will. They absolutely will. Keep your eye on the prize. And always give a little more than you think you got. That's, you know, when you're really pushing to make the grade, you're going to give a little extra, little extra, little extra. That's why I always give a little extra time here. You know, I think I could stop now. I said, no, let's see if I can give a little more, a little more. And we don't have to focus so much on the loss narratives, you know, economic problems, all this stuff has been doubled down on already. We don't have enough, because we're not, if we're not going to follow it, why focus on it so much? You know, mention it, it's worth, these things are worth a mention, some of the stuff I point out, just to remind you that you really have to make a decision which narrative to follow. As far, is it going to be a loss-based narrative or a no-loss narrative? Make the choice that the loss-based, following the loss-based narrative, may be more than you want at all, for sure. You know, it's going to be very intense. Has been very intense, really. The last 30 years have been super intense. So intense, you know, it's like people are eager to get on to the next loss, you know, so they don't even think back. I said, now wait a minute, remember back in the 80s when all this stuff was happening? Hey, how come we're not sorting that out and saying, now wait a minute, you put the brakes on? No, nobody's interested. They're on to the next thing. They're pushing their narrative. The narrative of loss is being pushed. That's kind of my point when I talk about the etheric vampires and all that, is the narrative of loss is being pushed severely. So we have to push the narrative of non-loss very severely. Not countering loss, the narrative of no loss. Okay? The narrative of being, of having the entire scenario of loss pass us by. That is the narrative that we have to push, because the other narrative is being pushed on us incredibly, incredibly. And it's like no matter how fast we go, you know, it's like the hounds of hell are right nipping at our heels. Really, it's unbelievable, because this has been planned for a long, long time. What's happening now has been in the planning stages for a long time. That's why Jesus could talk about it 2,000 years ago and say, hey, this is what's going to happen in 2,000 years. Because the plans for it were very much being worked on at that time, and even before that time. And we got a couple thousand years of warning on this. And so now these plans are very advanced. And now the whole scenario is being pushed, you know, full speed ahead. And of course there are all sorts of snags and snafus and troubles they're having and doubling down. There's all sorts of unintended consequences and stuff that messes them up, etc. So it doesn't go smooth for them. It doesn't go smooth. You know, it's like in any like assault, you know, like the, you know, blitzkrieg assault. Everything's planned ahead of time, but it doesn't always go smooth. Stuff happens that you don't expect, but the narrative is still advanced. For instance, in World War II, the Germans were able to advance their narrative, you know, to a very significant extent, even though a lot of little stuff didn't go the way they hoped it would. But enough did. They just kept advancing the narrative. They weren't crying about it. They just kept pushing. Same thing with this world-based sacrifice. That, of course, it's going to be bumpy for them, but they're just going to keep advancing this narrative. Just occurred to me that the those etheric vampires who are, you know, milking us for energy are running a bluff on the world too. But they're saying, you know what? The whole world is going to be destroyed, but if you agree to serve us, we'll somehow lift you up, you know, out of harm's way if you become our slave or something like that. So they're using your fear of destruction to agree to enslavement. Now, they're not wrong about the destruction. What they're wrong about is that they leave out the option of escaping destruction altogether. and escaping them too, escaping enslavement and destruction, both, you see. So those who want to enslave are frantically working to try and get as many people here now to agree to their quote-unquote protection. And in exchange, they will be indentured servitors, have their energy constantly sucked out of them, as it were. They'll be energy slaves. It's a bad deal. And what's left out of that narrative is, again, escaping that enslavement and escaping the loss in this world. All of that, escaping all of it. But again, there are those who are exploiting the situation here by thinking they can get a lot of slaves because people are getting so scared about the problems that come in this world, they're gonna look for help, say, oh, please, you know, will you help us? And they say, sure, you just need to agree, you know, to this. And people, you know, will jump at it, so to speak. But right now people are saying, I don't know, I'm not sure. Many have decided that, thinking, you know, if they can shift up into the etheric realm, that they will then be spared, you know, the destruction at this realm. But we're not talking about shifting up to the etheric realm. We're talking about paradise. We're talking about the loss-free realm. Totally different, where no loss is possible of any kind. It's effortless. Where the entire scenario of loss passes us by, that's a totally different thing. People are being trained to be indentured servants right now with credit card companies in debt. That's how it's done. One of the ways it's done, with the mortgages being underwater, all the troubles with the mortgage bubble. That's how it's being done. Feeling like an indentured servant, which is what I am right now. I'm literally an indentured servant. Seeing what's going on in this world, you know, I allow myself to see what is going on here. And all that stuff, what it does is it gets you ready to simply be a slave. Be a slave of these subtle entities. Like in the past, serfs, you know, there'd be some war and some powerful warlord would come and says, you know what, I got this big castle on the hill and y'all come up there and you can live there, and all you got to do in return for my protection is you got to bind yourself and your offspring in perpetuity to work these lands and serve in my army and do all this stuff for me, you know. And so people say, oh, it's either be killed or accept this offer of protection. And so a lot of them accepted the offer of protection from these, you know, powerful warlords who had the castles. It's like that. It's like there's an etheric castle, as it were, that seems to be, you know, a place of refuge, of safety, and that you have to sell your soul, as it were, your energy bodies. You have to agree to have your energy bodies tapped by these entities for their purposes. And that's a very bad deal to make. Very bad. Don't make that deal. Focus your narrative on escaping the entire scenario of trying to build up a resume of victimization and loss and vulnerability. All of it. And be free. Okay, in paradise, you're free. You're not an indentured servant. You're not owing your protection to some warlord who's fighting off the wicked invaders or anything like that. There's no invasion. There's no danger. There's nothing you need to be protected from. That is the goal. So you have all sorts of situations here. Knowing that we're under pressure, we're liable to leap, you know, to wherever we see safety, we're going to leap there. And so there are many, you know, very clever operatives, subtle in the subtle levels, that think that they can, you know, hey, they can get, you know, millions of slaves for their purposes. And they don't, you know, the problems are going to come in this world anyway. Of course, they have worked to bring a lot of those problems about, but the problems that are coming are also cosmic problems. All different levels of problems are coming. And so it's kind of like, let's say there's a very clever warlord, and there's all these free serfs, you know, free people working their farms and everything. And the warlord says, wow, I'd really like to get them indentured to me, because that would make me very powerful. And I'd get everything I think that I want. So what does the warlord do? The warlord goes over to a neighboring warlord and says, hey, let's make a deal. I've got this. Let's make a plan. And the other warlord says, what's your plan? He says, I want you to attack my kingdom. I want you to attack my kingdom, my little kingdom. And I want you to start slaughtering all the, you know, the people that live in my kingdom there, or the area that where I live. And the other warlord says, why? Why? He says, so then they will flee to the castle, and I will say, you know what, everybody, this terrible warlord's invading, and I'm offering you safety from this horrible barbarian who wants to slaughter all of you. Okay? So they all will agree to be indentured servitude in perpetuity. And the other warlord says, well, okay, I see where you're coming from, but what's in it for me? And then they kind of think and say, yeah, okay. And then the other warlord says, ah, I got an idea. I'll do that for you. And then I want you to do the same for my little kingdom. I want you in turn to invade my little kingdom. And that'll drive all the free people of my area to my castle, and I can indenture servitude all of them. It's a win-win, you see. And then the two warlords will say, wow, we're pretty clever here, very tricky, you know. And of course it worked. So the fact is, in existence, that people are in subtle cahoots, in collaboration like that. It's like the one who is supposedly saving you, but really leading you into indentured servitude, they're the ones that set up the endangerment of you in the first place. Okay, and now here they come, you know, all pretty, like, oh, you're in such terrible trouble. Isn't that awful? You know what? I just happen to have a place, you know, that you can be saved. And you think, oh my gosh, you're so wonderful. Thank you so much. And they say, but in order to do that, you need to agree to, you know, all this indentured servitude. And you say, well, that's better than what I'm facing here. So you grab a hold of that, you see. Fact is that one who's offering you safety like that, and not paradise, but some safety in the loss-based realms, they're the ones who set up your endangerment in the first place to drive you right into their trap. It's all about entrapment here, okay? Very much so. So you have to listen to the voice of reason, the voice, divine voice of God that speaks for God, of reality, and set your sights on the narrative of true escape. Okay, true escape. The Passover principle is not that you escape anything, it's that everything else flees you, because it doesn't see any loss there, any opportunity for loss, so they say, forget it. I'm not going to waste my time with this one at all. That is true escape. It is not the ones who say, yeah, you're in a terrible shape, looks like you're going to be wiped out, but you know what? I've got a place where you can hang out, and we've got all sorts of defenses, and we can prevent this stuff from happening. And I said, what's the cost? Minimal cost. Okay, remember, all of existence is based on trying to con the prime creator into changing a tiny, tiny, tiny fragment of reality. In exchange, we won't touch any of the rest of reality. That's the whole narrative of existence. So the people in existence, everyone has this narrative, as it were. And so when they offer you safety, they'll say, well, yeah, I mean, you know, it's fine, no troubles, you know. And just, well, this is a little thing, you know, like what, you know. And then you find out it's, you know, slavery. You find out it's a huge thing, it's a terrible thing, it totally, you're not free, you're not safe at all. Because they say, well, if you don't do what I tell you to do, I'm going to cast you back into the jaws of death, you know, that kind of thing. Whereas the loss-free realm of the paradise realm is simply there. And when we accept the Passover principle, the whole scenario of loss passes us by, and we find ourselves there in that way. It's not asking anything of us. It's not saying, I will defend you against the invaders or something. There's no invaders. There's no defense needed. There's no deal at all there. None. It's not like, well, if you don't act right, I'm going to throw you back out. No. If you want to pad your lost resume, you will find yourself, cast yourself out. But if you don't want to pad your victim resume, you remain. It's not doing anything to you. So it's entirely different. Entirely different. And, you know, need to differentiate this way, because, you know, if you don't accept that, there'll be conditions. Love, true love is unconditional love. Unconditional love. No conditions. There are no conditions to the lost free realm at all. No conditions. It doesn't put any conditions. It simply is there for you when you decide that you no longer want to pad your victim resume. Okay? When you no longer want to pad your resume of loss, the Passover principle will automatically move you there. That's it. It's that simple. There's no strings attached, no conditions whatsoever. Very different than the rest of the other scenarios. Very different. So even if you should accept one of those other scenarios, realize the Passover principle will save you from that too, because there will be strings attached to those other scenarios. Like a beautiful goddess may come to you and say, come to my kingdom. I have this unbelievably beautiful kingdom. And she'll show it to you and you'll say, oh my gosh, there are flowers everywhere. It's so beautiful. Wow. She says, you'll be safe there. And so you go there. And then she says, you know, all you got to do is just keep these plants from dying. You know, and you say, well, how do I do that? She says, well, you got to find a way. You say, oh my gosh, what a burden. So every morning you get up early in the morning, you're looking at every single plant to see if there's any signs of it dying. And if there is, somehow you frankly got to hide it, you know, and do something. So your whole mind becomes obsessed with how do I keep this, or the goddess's little kingdom here, how do I keep any sign of death out of there? And you become a basket case. Horrible. Horrible. Plus, you have to keep expanding it, planting more plants, more flowers, more beauty everywhere, and that just adds to your burden. Before, you know, now you have lots more that you have to keep all evidence of death away. It's like Gautama Buddha had, his parents had this vast estate, you know, and they had all these workers, an army of workers, keeping all any sign of loss away. And the workers were, you know, frantically. You think they were happy? No, they were terrified, you know, because if they overlook, let's say there's like a flower has bloomed and now it's all wilted, they forgot to pick it, you know, cut it so it doesn't even show it's ever been there. And the queen or the king saw that and they say, off with their head, you know, off with their head. So you get to those kind of scenarios of a beautiful kingdoms like that, and you under this death sentence, that off with your head if you miss one little flower. Or if you miss blowing the leaves off the walk, so the goddess comes out in the morning and everything's perfect, no leaves, no sign of death. They look out and she goes, ah, look at my kingdom. You must be so happy to be here. Look what I've done for you. Look what I'm giving you. You know, so, you know, everyone here is so happy. And you're like shaking, you know, yeah, I'm really happy. Yeah, this is just incredible. This is what I think I want. Yeah. And then she leaves, you go, oh my gosh, and you're frantically looking, and she goes, did she see that the flower over there in the corner? No, gosh, she didn't see it. It's dead, I gotta pick that one. And, oh my gosh, you know, there's a problem over here, the wind is blowing, the wind starts blowing at night, you jump up at 3 a.m. and you're out there, say, oh gosh, I gotta get rid of all these leaves before morning. So your life is a nightmare, absolute nightmare. And then of course she says, aren't you so fortunate and blessed to be here? And you have to say, oh yes, goddess, you've offered me the most wonderful opportunity. I'm totally devoted to you forever, you know. And she smiles and says, that's wonderful. And then you're back to, oh my god, how do I keep this all together? It's horrible. It's the worst. It's better to work in the salt mines, you know, getting whipped, really. Because this other one is like 24/7, you're freaking out. At least in the salt mines, you work your day and then you sleep at night. You know, eat your breakfast, get up in the morning, then you say, okay, I got to go to the salt mines again. You know, terrible, terrible, terrible. I'm going to die in the salt mines. But this other scenario it's like you're freaking out 24/7. You can't even sleep because you got to make sure that no evidence of loss or death is evident to the goddess who's, you know, this is, and she thinks that she's the most benevolent being possible, giving you this opportunity to dwell in this. She goes, look at how lovely this place is. And you get to dwell here. You are so blessed to dwell here because everything is so wonderful and lovely. And you're saying, oh, yes, 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 I know. I'm blessed beyond anyone else. Nobody's more blessed than me. And then you're like, your nerves are shot, you know, and you're going crazy because, you know, some damn squirrel just, you know, dropped a walnut on the path. Ah, I got to get that walnut. I got to sweep up all the walnut pieces, you know. The squirrels are grabbing all the walnuts and they, you know, opening up and dropping all the stuff down. You're saying, ah, you know, the birds came and they did some damage. Like last night, the deer came here and ate all our tomatoes, plucked them clean. I got hardly any tomatoes, all gone. They ate all of them. It's incredible, you know? And what if you got up in the morning and saw that and you say, oh my God, the goddess cannot see that. What do I do? She's going to kill me if she sees that. It's like, then you freak out and you just say, I'm going to die. I'm going to die. And then you make up some desperate story. Say, you know what? I'm going to plant, you know, 50 times more and they're going to be perfect this time. I guarantee you, you got to plead for your life, constantly pleading for your life because all this stuff keeps happening. And you have to desperately plead for your life. That's worse than the salt mines. Salt mines, you know, the overseers know you hate them. And you hate your job and everything. They said, but yeah, I know. You just got to keep doing it, though. So, you know, there's much less pretense involved. Much less pretense. You're a slave. You got to do this. You hate it. You got to want to be free. Everybody knows that. And yet, you know, you can't really find a way, so you're still working. Whereas the other one, you got to engage in this massive pretense that you're somehow happy and blessed and it's no problem, you know. No effort. She goes, it's not difficult for you here, is it? You say, oh, no. He said, you're not working too hard, are you? Oh, no. No, it's a piece of cake. What do you mean? I mean, everything's fine. I'm not, is it really? Oh, yeah. Are you getting enough sleep? Oh, plenty of sleep, sure. Of course. Why not? Of course I'm getting sleep. So everything's fine? Oh, it's great. It's just great. You have to engage in this hideous pretense. So in paradise, there is no maintenance. In true paradise, there's no maintenance. Maintenance free, 100%. Nobody does any maintenance. That is a fact. So there's no pretense necessary. No pleading for your life. No freaking out, you know. Oh, I got something happened. I got to fix it, you know. The water main broke, you know, and it's flooding everything. Some birds came and, you know, attacked the crops, you know. A flood, you know, the fields are flooding. What do I do? And no pretense necessary. No tyrant to appease whatsoever. So when you find yourselves in these lousy scenarios, just realize, hey, Passover principle. Alignment towards I no longer need to pad my resume. Because my resume is useless. Resume of loss is useless. Admit to the Prime Creator, yes, this is what I've been trying to do. I've been trying to use my resume of loss to convince you, to threaten you into changing a little tiny bit of reality and offering this as some magnanimous deal. That's what I've been trying to do. And now I don't want to do that anymore, so I want to be oriented towards no loss at all. Okay. Then you are activating that Passover principle. And even the goddess herself can't hold you in her kingdom. Cannot. It has to pass you by. No matter what you've said in the past, no matter what pretenses you've engaged in, it has to pass you by. She'll be looking for you. Say, I can't see anywhere. I can't find him. Where is he? Where's my workers? You know. I don't see him. They're vanished. I don't know. I have no idea where they went. Vanished. Oh well. Passover principle. You become non-existent to existence, as it were. But you're not non-existent to paradise, the lost free realm. You are absolutely existent in that realm. but you are non-existent to existence because it sees absolutely no use for you whatsoever. So keep in mind, you always have that with you. Everybody does, no matter where they find themselves. And there are a lot of scenarios coming up. People will find themselves in all sorts of agreements coming up because this planet, this 3D planet, is slated for some major remodeling, as it were, total makeover. So there'll be all sorts of divergent, you know, offers and scattering and going to all these places. Wherever you go, realize the Passover principle can always be activated. You can always activate it, no matter where you are. Makes no difference where you are. You just see, I remember what existence, what I'm really doing, what I'm trying to do, how I'm trying to accomplish it. I'm trying to be Prime Creator, therefore I'm trying to change reality, and I can't change reality, so I'm trying to get Prime Creator to change reality for me. And I'm trying to build up a resume of loss and destructivity so that I can go to the Prime Creator with all this evidence and resume and say, look, there is this power. I'm showing you there is this power that can destroy everything. And I'm going to destroy all of reality unless you agree. And I make you a deal, though, because I want to show you I'm very loving. I'm very compassionate. I'll make you a deal. I won't destroy all of reality if you simply change a tiniest little sliver of reality for me. Just make that one little change. Then we have a deal, and I'll leave the rest of it intact. That is what we've been doing, period. And you can see that anywhere you are, no matter where you are. You can realize that. You can see it. You can repent. You can say, you know what? This doesn't work. You can see it doesn't work. God can't change reality. Nothing can change reality. God is reality. God can't change that fact, right? And the way that reality is the way that it is. And if even the tiniest bit were changed, the entirety of it would be changed. It would not be reality anymore. It would be annihilated. So that deal will never be struck. There is no deal on the table with God. Never be struck. All our attempt to accumulate this bargaining chip has been wasted time. So don't keep wasting time. Decide, you know what? Enough's enough. I don't want to keep adding on to it. Align yourself that way. And you activate the Passover principle. You really do. I've experienced that. I can testify to it, that more and more and more and more I'm experiencing this Passover principle. People are like looking for me. They can't even find me. In my life, I've had so many situations where people, I'm invisible. People don't even see me. I'm just standing right there, and, you know, like, they don't even see me. Like, for them, I don't exist in their existence. I don't even exist. Barely exist to them. You know, they say, oh, yeah, how come I didn't see you? Wow, that's amazing. I didn't even see you there. People walk right in line. And I gave up trying to get mad at people. I just let them do it. I just look and say, oh, that's interesting. Looks like they didn't even see me. And a lot of times when people do that, and someone else in line does see me, you know, because they have some awareness going on, right? And they'll look, and they'll look, and we'll look at each other, and we'll smile, you know, just kind of smile and nod. They'll say, didn't even see me, right? And they shake their head and say, wow, how's that possible? I mean, you're standing right there, and someone just went right in front of you, and they had no awareness you're even there. And, you know, they start thinking, I see they're thinking, like, what the heck's going on? That is weird. And someday, you know, they will get insight into that and realize, oh my gosh, you know, that one has the Passover principle working for them. It's true. It's really true. Now, if I can only get the debt collectors to the Passover principle work with the debt collectors, right? The credit card companies, etc., etc., then that would be good too. But you know, we're all in situations where the Passover principle is super important for us. Everybody, you know, we're all in a situation like, say, oh my gosh, I really need something to pass me over. But what we want is all of it to pass us over at this point. All of it. You know, we don't pick and choose. Don't pick and choose. Don't say, yeah, I want the banks to pass me over, but I don't want other stuff to pass me over. Now, those who are also on the Passover principle path narrative, you won't lose them because they won't Passover, they'll remain with you. The awareness, they'll be aware of you, you'll be aware of them, etc. Of course. But the rest of the world will pass you over, pass all of you over. Anyone who's on the Passover the principal path will be passed over. So it may be at this time many will find themselves going to paradise at the same time, or relatively the same time frame, many in this world. Somebody say it's 144,000. I don't care how many it is. I don't pay any attention to how many. It doesn't make any difference to me. If it's just one or everybody, whatever. It's not important. Not important. I hope it's everybody, It's not looking that way at this point, is it? You'd be hard pressed to find 144,000 at this point too, but maybe there is that many in the world. It's very possible, yeah. Maybe there's more than that. That's possible too. That's just it's a symbolic number. It's just a symbolic number. Don't worry about numbers. But so those who are on the Passover path will, of course, they'll still see you. They'll say, "Hi, how you doing?" And we'll smile and say, "Hey, these other people don't even recognize us." And we'll say, "Yeah, I know. Isn't that something? It's amazing. I've always been passed over. I used to get upset about it. I do super good at something, like trying to make a team or something. I was just fabulous. I was the best player. I was super, super good at certain stuff. And the coach wouldn't choose me, and everyone else would make it, and I would be left off, and they wouldn't even recognize that I even tried out. I said, I tried out, and they said, "What? Huh? I never saw you. I don't even know who you are." I said, "Coach, I'm in there hitting home run. I'm doing all this stuff, and you don't even know who I am?" They said, "No, you're not on the team." I said, "Wow. Wow, that is bizarre." And I used to take it the wrong way, thinking like, "Wow, these people are really persecuting me. They hate me. What's going on here?" It's taken me a long time to understand it. Whatever accolades or acknowledgement from the world, it simply didn't come. Doesn't come. Doesn't arrive at all. I said, "That is really, really amazing. What's going on?" Passover principle. Passover principle. That you no longer serve their purpose at all, or to such a small extent you're not even on their radar. You don't even show up. I could pitch a perfect game, and the coach says, "Oh, you didn't make the team," or "I don't want you on the team," because you're not serving the deeper purpose that I want to be served. So I can't help but pass you over. It's automatic. It's automatic, and you argue with them. It doesn't get anywhere. You can bring up all these facts. Say, "Coach, I hit over 500. I did this and this and this and this." And the coach said, sorry, can't be on the team." I say, "Wow, you're not being reasonable." But the truth is my attitude was oriented towards Passover principle. So they literally couldn't see any purpose for me, For their purpose, I didn't serve their purpose at all. So they couldn't include me on the team. They could not. So you don't need to be included on the sacrificial team, all right? The team of loss, the victimization team, the victimizer team. You don't need to be included on those teams at all. So let them pass you by. Let them pass you by, because they say, "This won't help at all." That's good. Don't be hurt by it. Don't let your, don't get an ego complex saying, "I'm really hurt. I know I can help out. If they just let me help, I can help." Now say, "Oh, great, great, great. The Passover principle's working. Passover principle's working here. Fabulous. That's fantastic." Let it keep working. Let it keep working. All right. If I post this now, it will be 10 o'clock prime time, so East Coast. So let me get my other video. I have one more video that I've already done. Let me get those posted so you have a whole prime time feast. See, I took yesterday off. I'm back Saturday, stronger than ever. And again, we're advancing this narrative as fast as possible, and saying it's okay if you're passed over. Don't take it personally if people don't care who you are. You're getting passed over for all sorts of stuff. Say, "Great, very great, very great. That's good. I like that." And you will find yourself in better and better situations. Somehow, that's the principle. Okay. Let's end this video right here. Very great.